Members, we shall get started with the next session where we deal with the estimates of expenditure on health. Before I invite the secretary to speak, I would invite members to raise their hand. To allow members to speak in an orderly and fair manner, would the staff please clear the existing raise hand markers for members? Members who intend to speak, please press the raise hand button in the Zoom system. I would first invite Professor Sophia Chan to speak before I open up the floor for questions. Professor Chan. Chairman, members, good morning. In the year 2022 to 23, the estimated recurrent government expenditure on healthcare is $126.6 billion. Which accounts for 22.5% of the government's total recurrent expenditure. From 2019 to 20 to 2022 to 23, the recurrent provision on healthcare has recorded a cumulative growth of 54%. New and additional resources available in this financial year are mainly used for various enhanced or newly introduced public healthcare services as follows. On the support for the hospital authority, the government will continue to increase progressively the recurrent provision for DHA according to the triennium funding arrangement agreed in 2017, having regard to population growth rates and demographic changes. In 2022-23, a recurrent subvention of $90.4 billion will be provided to DHA, representing an increase of over 60% compared with 2017-18, $7.5 billion of which will be used for further supporting DHA in combating COVID-19, including operating the North Lantau Hospital Hong Kong Infection Control Center and other treatment or isolation facilities, as well as procuring medicine, equipment, and other necessities. DHA will also utilize the funding to enhance its services, including one, attracting and retaining staff to alleviate manpower shortage and constraint, including enhancing promotion opportunities of associate consultants, re-employing retired doctors, and providing a specialty nurse allowance. Two, increasing the quota for general outpatient clinics and specialist outpatient clinic attendances. Three, providing about 390 additional public hospital beds and providing extra operating theater sessions. Four, enhancing clinical services such as radiology, pathology, pharmacy, and day services, as well as services on chronic diseases, including cancer and mental illness. And five, adopting new technologies to improve patient care and develop smart hospitals. In 2022 to 23, an additional time-limited provision of about $1.138 billion will be provided to the Department of Health. $6.399 billion total time-limited provision for 3 years from 21 to 22 to 23 to 24 for taking various measures in combating COVID-19. While an additional provision of over $6 billion will be provided to the DH to implement the next round of the COVID-19 vaccination program. In the coming year, the DH will continue to strengthen the existing public health services and introduce new services, including replenishing the existing stockpile of antivirals for dealing with an influenza pandemic, improving the uptake rate of seasonal influenza vaccination, and launching a new program at Yamate Integrated Treatment Center to provide comprehensive clinical care for the prevention of HIV, viral hepatitis, and sexually transmitted infections among men who have sex with men, and employing an integrated approach in offering counseling on drug use and mental health to clients. In terms of healthcare facilities, DHA will press ahead with the implementation of the projects under the first 10-year hospital development plan. We plan to seek funding approval from the Finance Committee for three projects under the first 10-year HDP in the current legislative session and look forward to members' support. In response to the Northern Metropolis Development Strategy announced in the 2021 policy address, DHA is also actively reviewing and planning for the second 10-year HDP to dovetail with the government's plan. In addition, DHA will review the design of hospital projects under the two 10-year HDPs, taking into account the experience in combating COVID-19, and will incorporate the required provisions for two or three general wards in each selected hospital to be readily converted into tier 2 isolation wards in an epidemic situation. In the first 10-year HDP, the HA plans to provide not less than 300 additional tier 2 isolation beds in 5 hospitals with works underway. In terms of healthcare manpower training, to step up our efforts in coping with the continuous healthcare manpower shortage in the future, the government will earmark a recurrent provision of $400 million starting from the 2023 to 24 financial year for the following purposes related to healthcare manpower training. These include, 1, providing subsidies for students to enroll in taught postgraduate programs on healthcare offered by University Grants Committee funded universities, self-financing post-secondary institutions, or public healthcare institutions. Students who have successfully completed the programs can become healthcare professionals. And 2, providing 500 extra designated places under the study subsidy scheme for designated professions or sectors to subsidize students to take self-financing undergraduate programs on healthcare. In addition to the $20 billion earmarked in 2018 to upgrade and increase the teaching facilities of the University of Hong Kong, Chinese University of Hong Kong, and Hong Kong Polytechnic University, the government will set aside another $10 billion to ensure sufficient funding for the completion of all planned projects. Upon completion of these facilities, it is expected that the 3 universities will have the capacity to cope with about 900 extra training places for medical, nursing, and allied health professions. Around $2.1 billion were allocated to the 3 universities in the past 3 financial years to carry out some of their short-term and medium-term projects. The government will submit funding applications for another 2 projects totaling $1 billion to the FC in the current legislative session, and will continue to follow up with the 3 universities on the remaining medium and long-term projects with a view to further upgrading and increasing their healthcare teaching facilities. On primary healthcare, the government will continue to vigorously promote district-based primary healthcare services with a view to enhancing the public's capability in personal health management and providing community support for patients with chronic disease. Following the commissioning of the district health centers in Kwai Ching and Sham Shui Po in September 2019 and June 2021, respectively, we are actively preparing for the setting up of DHCs in 5 other districts, namely Wong Tai Sin, Tuen Mun, Southern District, Yuen Long, and Chun Wan, which are expected to commence operation gradually within the year. Meanwhile, the government allocated around $600 million 2 years ago to subsidize the establishment of smaller interim DHC Express in the remaining 11 districts by NGOs with a view to expediting the provision of primary healthcare services on a district level. All 11 DHC Express commenced services progressively last year. On the development of Chinese medicine, the government has incorporated Chinese medicine into the local public healthcare system and has continued to allocate more recurrent resources to develop CM services. The preparation work for commissioning the first Chinese medicine hospital in Hong Kong, one of the flagship institutions aiming to promote the development of CM, is actively underway. We have selected the Hong Kong Baptist University as the contractor of the service deed for CMH operation through a tendering exercise. In accordance with the service deed, the university has incorporated a company limited by guarantee as the operator of the CMH, being responsible for its management, operation, and maintenance. In parallel, the government is establishing a permanent government Chinese Medicines Testing Institute, or GCMTI, to be managed by the DH adjacent to the CMH. The GCMTI will specialize in the testing of and scientific research on CM drugs with a view to setting reference standards for the safety, quality, and testing methods of CM drugs and empowering the CM drug industry through transfer of technology to strengthen quality control of CM drugs and their products. The design and construction contracts for the CMH and GCMTI were awarded by the Architectural Services Department in June. The construction works commenced immediately and are expected to be completed by 2025. We will continue to further facilitate the development of CM in Hong Kong through various measures, including continuing the provision of subsidized CM outpatient clinics or services at the district level through the 18 district CM clinics administered by the HA, further enhancing the provision of inpatient services with integrated Chinese Western medicine treatment in HA hospitals, and stepping up efforts to support the CM sector to, along other things, nurture talent, conduct scientific research, and promote CM through the Chinese Medicine Development Fund. At the same time, with the country's strong support, the government will continue to strengthen the use of CM on all fronts in the fight against the epidemic, so that CM would play a more active role in the whole process of epidemic prevention, treatment, and recovery. In terms of testing for COVID-19 in 2022 to 23, the FHB will allocate a total of $19.25 billion to step up testing efforts, including maintaining community testing services, conducting restriction testing declaration operations, procuring rapid antigen test kits and related services, as well as meeting other testing or related service needs so as to achieve the objective of early identification, early isolation, and early treatment, and cut the transmission chains in the community as soon as possible. Chairman, my colleagues and I are happy to answer questions from members. Thank you. Thank you very much. I would now read out the names of members who wish to speak, 4 minutes each. And if time allows, I would consider allowing other members to speak. The 18 members are waiting to speak: Peter Hsu, Edward Leung, Kingsley Wong, Kenneth Lau, Chao Siu Chong, Lam Chan Singh, Tommy Cheng, Kitson Yang, Wong Yun Shan, Ma Feng Kuo, Michael Tian, Duncan Chiu, Chao Men Kwong, Priscilla Leung, Leung Men Kwong, Regina Yip, So Cheng Wing, and Stanley Lee. Please be concise as you speak. Mr. Peter Hsu, 4 minutes. Thank you. I did not get a chance to speak in the previous session, so I might ask some questions about health. SHE048. And the question was about the utilization of CM services, which the secretary just talked about. But in light of COVID-19, in terms of the use of Chinese medicine, I think it could have been adopted earlier. For elderly residents in residential care homes, it was obvious that taking Chinese medicine would relieve their symptoms. So the secretary should reinforce the application of CM. FHB FE025. So that was about your work with hygiene, refuse collection, public toilets, etc. The total provision went up by $630 million or 11%. You said the total allocation is $6.4 billion. When you look at street hygiene, including markets, you often see trash piling up. You have 40 dedicated teams. I think that number should go up by 50% to reach 60. In terms of street obstructions, how are you going to tackle the problem at the end of the day? You should issue summonses after you take photos. That would be the most effective approach. For vegetables and other supplies arriving in Hong Kong every day, they arrive in styrofoam boxes. And these boxes would be recycled on the mainland, and then these boxes would be used to bring more vegetables to Hong Kong. But now the problem is that these styrofoams could not be returned to the mainland. Let's assume these foams measure 60 by 45 by 30 centimeters. We have 100,000 such boxes in Hong Kong. That's why we see them everywhere. Even if they are disposed at landfills, the EPD is trying to reduce the number of plastic bags, but we still see so many of these boxes lying around. I think you should have a discussion with the mainland authorities. Hong Kong has enough trash already. I have relayed this issue to the Environment Bureau, but nothing came of it. The wholesale markets and streets are full of these styrofoam boxes.
Secretary, there are two questions from the previous session. Right, if I may address the polystyrene foam boxes first, the FHB and the AFCD, together with the ENB, will liaise with the mainland counterparts to take forward our work. I fully appreciate what Mr. Peter Shield said. Some of the polystyrene foam boxes are lying around on the roadside. The ENB has got in touch with some of the market traders for them to put the boxes in the appropriate location to facilitate collection and removal. They should be put near the refuse collection point. Earlier, we liaised with the mainland authorities to reflect the situation. We will take this forward. Chinese medicine, in our battle against COVID, we have attached importance to TCM. This is an important part of our work. Earlier, we focus our attention on prevention and recovery. At a later stage, we had mainland specialist or TCM specialist who came to Hong Kong to offer a lot of insight and support. And there are protocols recommended for us. In the days to come, other than the prevention and recovery and treatment work in the context of COVID, we also would promote the use of Chinese medicine at home for those who are isolating at home, and also for those who are isolating in the CIF, and also for the recovered people. We are providing the CM services as well. The 18 Chinese medicine clinic come research centers, and also in the Chinese medicine development fund, we also provide 20,000 places for the infected patients to receive the telemedicine service, and for medicine distribution service, and we can cover more patients as time goes by. Mr. Edward Lau. Chairman, thank you. O37. About the asthma patients, the speaker not coming through. I can't quite hear you, Chairman. Am I coming through? Am I coming through? You have a fuzzy line there. Well, let me try again. For the GOPC, they do have the asthmatic patients statistics, but not so much on the specialist outpatient clinic. So I think a comprehensive set of statistics would be important. I bring up asthma, because a lot of the NGOs are telling us that internationally they are recommending the ICS to replace a SABA as a drug, because of a SABA, there is a risk of relapse, and there is also a risk of death. So why don't we follow the international standard and use the ICS drug? Thank you, Chairman. Thanks very much, Mr. Leung. Perhaps the HA can supplement regarding the SOPC and the asthma treatment and the standard for the use of drugs. HA? Chairman, thank you. We do attach importance to this issue. Asthma is a common ailment. For serious cases, they will go to the specialist outpatient clinic. For particularly serious cases, we do have a specialist treatment for them. In terms of treatment, we understand that it is commonly seen illness. Mr. Leung referred to beta 2 androgenic agonist, or SABA. We're trying to control the condition with steroid. All along, we have the expert committee, which is looking at the use of drugs in the light of international practices. In the market out there, there is new drug. There are new drugs coming on stream, and our mechanism will be reviewed on a regular basis. Having regard to the experts' views and international practices and the views of the patients' organizations. I've got 20 seconds left. Will you be using more or safer drugs, or is it because that kind of drug is too expensive and that's why you're not using it? A steroid drug has been in use for a long time, and we would assess the efficacy, and where necessary, we will introduce alternative drugs. Mr. Kingsley Wong. Chairman, thank you. Secretary, FHBH 051, there's the cross-boundary provision of healthcare. Because of the pandemic, the administration has taken on board the FTU's suggestion for Hong Kong people who are having a follow-up consultation. They can get the treatment at the University of Hong Kong Shenzhen Hospital, and the healthcare voucher has been in use dramatically, 6,000 in 2017 and 39,000 in 2021, fourfold increase. Many more Hong Kong people are residing in the mainland, in particular in the GBA. We have hundreds of, or tens of hundreds of thousands of people residing in GBA. And there are many Hong Kong people in the mainland, and they find that this support scheme is very, very good. It's been, we have 6,000 or so people for the past year or so that have already received the service, and they are happy with the quality of the HKU SZH hospital. Now, there are a lot of specialist cases that have a long waiting time. Now, in this support scheme at the Hong Kong U Shenzhen Hospital, what is the level of subsidy for each patient? Is it higher than that in Hong Kong or lower? If it is not too much higher, then will the administration be regularizing this support scheme So the people can take advantage of this special support scheme without having to come back to Hong Kong for the follow-up consultation. Can we allow the HA patients to have a choice to receive a specialist surgery in the Hong Kong Shenzhen Hospital? In Hong Kong, they probably will have to wait for 4 or 5 years for the surgery. Now, this is very convenient for Hong Kong people, and also to allow an alternative choice for people who are on the waiting list at the HA. And this will also take the pressure off the healthcare system in Hong Kong without having to increase the financial outlay on the part of the government. So will the Bureau be prepared to consider these options? Secretary, thanks very much, Mr. Wong. We are aware that more and more Hong Kong people are residing in the Greater Bay Area. In order to create a better living condition with better healthcare system all along, this is one of the objectives in our cooperation with the GBA. In terms of services, Mr. Wong said that with this pilot special support scheme together with the Hong Kong Yu Shenzhen Hospital, the need arises because of the pandemic. But it seems that this special support scheme has gone down very well among the users. And this special support scheme does give us a very good experience. If you want to extend this to other hospitals, that this is more like the outpatient service for other services. If we were to extend this to other services, we do have a wealth of experience to draw on. Now, we keep our options open if we want to cross the boundary and provide the healthcare services, perhaps to consider the healthcare record, the legislation, and so on. But that would not be an impediment to the provision of service. So depending on the needs, we will be liaising with the GBA and take forward on this kind of work. And Mr. Kenneth Lau, beg your pardon. Mr. Lau, Chairman, FHBH034, that's my question. The government is battling the fifth wave of COVID. 20 million doses of vaccines have been procured to make sure that we will have enough vaccines to tackle the pandemic. The government announced that those aged 60 and above, and they will be entitled to the fourth dose to enhance the protection in remote areas. Many senior citizens don't even have the first jab. Will the administration pay particular attention to the senior citizens in the rural areas and deploy outreach teams to vaccinate these senior citizens who are living in the rural areas? I'm sure that the rural committees will be cooperating with the government in this regard. Many people are concerned about how long the antibody will be lasting for after the fourth shot. Are we going to need the fifth and the sixth shot? The people of Hong Kong are anxious to find out more about this. I hope that the administration will let us know the roadmap in the battle against COVID going forward. Secretary, Chairman, indeed, we are concerned about the vaccine coverage for the senior citizens. A lot has been done to bring up the coverage. Now, Mr. Lau referred to the remote areas, the rural areas. How can we get in touch with the senior citizens and vaccinate them? Now, this is one of the focuses of our work. I've been to one of the vaccination mobile station in the rural area to see for myself. And I try to understand about the situation. There are many people who are getting the first shot or the second shot there. I did have a bit of a chat with some of the senior citizens there. So Mr. Lau, for Hong Yu Kuk and other organizations, if they really want to see more, of course, this is spearheaded by the CSB as far as the arrangement goes, but we are in the same government and we are taking forward and these got to work together. If Mr. Lau has any particular places in mind which are remote and inaccessible, we're only too delighted to make available the service for the first, second, or even the fourth shot. Like you said, Mr. Lau, if people have not even got the first shot, they must go get the jab quick.
As to the overall vaccination rate after the fourth shot is administered, the Joint Scientific Committee under the DH as well as the government's panel of advisors have been looking at the latest scientific evidence as well as local research outcome, and they would offer recommendations on our vaccination strategy going forward and specific strategies for different groups, and we will announce details when the time is right. We are very happy to work with the government to help vaccinate those who live in remote rural areas. COVID is highly transmissible. Even people who do not go out might contract the virus. We should not ignore people living in remote rural areas. In terms of dissemination of information, everyone has the right to acquire the latest information, and hopefully more could be done. Mr. Chao Siu-chung. Thank you. Secretary, I'd like to follow up on my own question, FHB H009. The reply talked about the additional allocation for the HA and a total of $7.7 billion in additional funding has been offered to the HA to deal with the winter surge of COVID. As of the 31st of January this year, the HA has spent $8.2 billion in total to fight COVID. Does this sum include the prior $7.7 billion allocated? Can you tell us how the $8.8 billion were spent? I received complaints in terms of the subsidies and supplies offered by different HA clusters to their frontline staff. The standards were different, and that affected staff morale. So my other question is about Chinese medicine. As we all know, there is great demand for CM services in light of COVID. However, additional funding for CM only amounts to $20 million. There was a case in which an 80-year-old elderly person called a hotline multiple times without success. That person went to a CM clinic and lined up for 2 hours, and still she was rejected. So that was far from ideal. At that time, the secretary promised that services would be reinforced. So can you provide an update or follow up on the situation? In a moment, I will invite DHA to explain how the $8.2 billion were spent. Mr. Chow talked about additional subsidies that would form part of the allocation. Another area of expenditure, testing services, extra services in light of COVID, manpower, vaccination, etc. I would invite the HA to offer details. In terms of Chinese medicine services, in Hong Kong, many people have contracted COVID and have since recovered. So for the 18 CMCTRs, they have received a lot of patients and they are rather stretched. Currently, a program under the Chinese Medicine Development Fund could support COVID patients who are recovering at home. We hope to mobilize resources from the private sector to offer services, and this is something we will continue to pursue. DHA, please. Thank you. In terms of the earlier $8.2 billion allocation, it was mainly spent on fighting the pandemic, including multiple rounds of funding under the Anti-Epidemic Fund. Mr. Chow talked about staff subsidy, personal supplies, etc. The subsidies make up a sizable portion of the sum. The disbursement of subsidies would follow uniform standards, but in light of changes to the pandemic in the past few years, our frontline staff are also often deployed across multiple posts. So in terms of communication with our staff, I believe there could be room for improvement, and we will consistently review the disbursement mechanisms, and we would offer support to our staff under uniform standards. Mr. Lam Chan Sing, I'd like to follow up on FHB022, which was a question I asked about Chinese medicine clinics. In 2021, the total attendance at the clinics at the 18 districts amounted to 1.27 million. For certain districts, they saw attendance of as much as 80 or 90,000. So for districts with a high demand, could an extra Chinese medicine clinic be open in order to answer the demand or to answer the service demand? In the year 2020, in terms of attendances of the 18 CMCTRs, the total was only 1.04 million. While there were 441 practitioners. And in 2021, the attendance rose to 1.27 million, but the number of Chinese medicine practitioners actually came down. So the attendance went up, but the number of practitioners actually came down. Would that affect service or lead to longer waiting time? An elderly person in his 70s learned about the free CM services offered by the government. He made multiple calls, but he never had an answer. So he had to visit the clinic in Sha Tin. but the staff there could not offer help and ask him to call again. I understand there is a great demand for CM services, but at least you can arrange an appointment for them. So hopefully you can improve your reservation services or turn to mobile apps to allow elderly persons to book CM services. Secretary, thank you very much. Mr. Lam asked questions about clinic attendance and manpower. We understand there is great demand for CM services under COVID, especially rehabilitation services. Many people in Hong Kong have recovered and there's a great demand for rehab services. The manpower currently at the CMCTLs is limited. So in this regard, we will see if anything could be done. Meanwhile, we must mobilize resources from the private sector to help satisfy the demand. Under the existing programs of the Chinese Medicine Development Fund, we would see what could be done. The HA will work with the 18 CMCTLs on how we can make CM booking service more user-friendly for elderly citizens. Dr. Koh, Mr. Lam asked about the attendance levels in 2020, 21, and 22. I think the changes were due to the pandemic. In 2020, the pandemic was rather serious. So there were changes in both our service levels and service demand. In terms of manpower, the current term government has officially incorporated CM in our healthcare landscape, and the clinics or Chinese medicine clinics became subvented government clinics. So there were adjustments to the facilities or services. As for manpower, the main change was induced by the number of trained CM practitioners. Some practitioners joined and others have left. So the attendance level was mainly dictated by service demand. Mr. Tommy Chang. Thank you. Secretary, Dr. Koh. I'd like to thank all frontline healthcare professionals in Hong Kong for their efforts over the past 2 years. We also express our gratitude to all mainland support staff who have rendered support to Hong Kong. And the Liberal Party is grateful for that. In the budget this year, funds were set aside for the HA to hire non-locally trained doctors, which was nice to see. I think you are rather optimistic, but I'm not too positive that many people would come back. I believe, I realize you have been attacked over the issue. In the 10th, over the past 10 years, we were talking about a ratio of two doctors per 1,000 people in recent months. In Singapore, there are 2.4 doctors per 1,000 people. In that case, based on that standard, we need 3,000 more standards. If we adopt the standard of 5.8 doctors per 1,000 people, we need 5,000 more doctors. Of course, we will never catch up with the standards on the mainland, but when we look at the situation over the past 10 years for universities in Hong Kong and the HA, the shortage of doctors was actually underestimated. Secretary, it's not about the level of shortage for doctors. People have to wait 3 to 6 months to meet a consultant for the first time. We must shorten the waiting time for appointments to acceptable levels. So you need to conduct an assessment. Secretary, are you going to work this out with the HA?
Secretary, Chairman, thank you very much, Mr. Cheung. Healthcare manpower is something that we are particularly concerned. We have achieved some breakthrough there. Locally, we are trying to retain staff, and we increasing resources, and we have the rehiring of the retirees, and we also have the special registration ordinance in order to attract more non-locally trained doctors. The limited registration system has yielded some recruits, although things are moving a little bit slowly, more slowly during COVID, but still the number is higher than previously. We will be moving ahead with this. As to how we can more effectively assess the doctor shortfall, now we have the manpower resources report, which is available every 3 years. Mr. Tommy Jones has made a lot of comments in this regard. But when it comes to the provision of services, the waiting time, the reform of the entire healthcare system, the expansion of the primary healthcare system, now, all these certainly would go a long way towards improving the level of service. So going forward, we will be looking at the ratio. We will also have regard to the local situation and in the international situation. The HA has the number of shortfall every single year. And we're also looking at increasing the resources and improving the retention and increasing the number of undergraduates and so on. We are working on all these different areas concurrently. Once we have the latest numbers, we will make the announcement. Mr. Kisson Yang, Chairman, thank you. O168 and O169, about the COVID drug. The government has introduced new drugs towards the end of last year. The new COVID drug has been given the approval for clinical trial. How soon will the administration announce the result of the clinical trial? And BVR6 of the Chinese Medicine Academy will be launched. And 0169 about liver disease. Liver cancer is the third highest killer. Hepatitis B is the main cause, 70 or 80% of the liver cancer stems from hepatitis B. They don't have any symptoms. If you do not monitor the situation, 25% of the cases are likely to develop cirrhosis and liver cancer. The symptoms are not apparent at the beginning, and people, there is a steering committee, and they are considering a screening of the high-risk people. I think this is a pragmatic approach. Will the government consider at the DH clinics consider providing a screening of liver cancer? For those age 35 and above, will there be any ultrasound test or screening for the liver cancer patients? Right, there are two parts to the question. Perhaps my colleague can supplement. For new drugs, if they are effective, we will pay particular attention. And I'm sure that the DH drug department would have regard to this. And we'll also look at the clinical performance at the universities and so on. The hepatitis B, the director of health and the chief executive of the hospital authority are the joint chairman of this joint committee. We do have some recommendation. We have achieved some progress. Perhaps my colleagues can bring us up to date. Director, chairman, thank you. In terms of development of pharmaceuticals, our pharmaceutical office under the DH has formulated two measures. The first one is an emergency registration mechanism. If there are drugs like the MSDs, molnupiravir, and also Paxlovid, of Pfizer, we have approved them under the emergency registration system. They must fulfill the condition of recognition in other parts of the world, and they must have the proven efficacy, and we can register them on an emergency basis. Now, for new drugs that will be used for clinical trial in Hong Kong, we do need to have some permits for clinical trial in Hong Kong. If they are related to COVID, we will expedite them in terms of the registration. As to the hepatitis, together with the hospital authority, we have a steering committee on the prevention and control of hepatitis. And we do have a five-year plan from 2020 to 2024. We have an action plan. And this is to tie in with the WHO's objective. In 2030, we aim to get rid of the threat of viral hepatitis. In our action plan, we have four major areas. The first one is to enhance the awareness on the part of the healthcare workers and the members of the public. Second, to enhance monitoring. And third, to do more promotion. And the fourth one is treatment. Mr. Yang referred to the extension of treatment. Dr. Lam, in interest of time, can you make it brief, please? We have already looked at the mother to child transmission. If the pregnant women are carriers, and they will be prescribed the medication, and there will also be serological follow-up after birth. Let's see whether Dr. Koh has got anything to add. Dr. Koh, please. Well, can you reduce that to writing, please? Next, Dr. Stephen Wong. Chairman, Secretary, two sets of questions. FHB H059 about the manpower situation. I remember in October last year, the medical registration ordinance has been passed to bring in the non-locally trained doctors. From the reply, it says that the first batch of locally, the first batch of recognized list would not be available until 2 months later. That's about the recognized medical schools that will be recognized. The bill has been passed for 6 months. We've been waiting for 6 months, but we need to have the list of medical schools. Why is it that we have to wait for 8 months now before the list would become available? Where do you get stuck? Has the Bureau made available the list to the committee, or have you done so already? The Secretary has been promoting these overseas, and what is the response so far? And third, when to expect the first batch will be arriving in Hong Kong? 001, question 001 about the Chinese medicine. The integrated Chinese Western medicine treatment program is being carried out. Will you be extending this pilot scheme to cover more diseases? Will this be expanded to cover more hospitals? There are 8 hospitals that are covered. My second question in this regard is, now for the CMCTRs, there are 18 all over Hong Kong and different districts. Will this be introduced to the GOPC as well? Secretary, two questions there. The first one is about the special registration committee, that the law has been enacted. And after the enactment of the ordinance, we can form the committee and for meetings to be convened. They are working very hard to come up with the list. Now, this is not a list provided by the FHB. They would have regard to the different medical schools around the world and their curriculum and their rankings and so on, and also the content of the curriculum. Before they take the decision, I believe that work is in hand, and the list will be made public in phases, and they will release the list as they go along. The second question is about the development of Chinese medicine. The FHB has been very concerned about this development. We have a development fund to the tune of $500 million. And your specific questions are the collaboration between Chinese and Western medicine, whether this will be deepened or broadened. The answer is yes. The HA takes forward this program for different illnesses for a number of years. And if we want to expand this integrated Chinese Western medicine program to other hospitals and other diseases, and they will review the situation on an ongoing basis. And during COVID, the contribution of Chinese medicine has been really significant. So they will be working on this going forward. And also for the 18 Chinese medicine clinics cum training and research centers, CMCTRs, we are progressively increasing the number of available tickets for the patients, for them to attend the clinics. The people are more familiar with the practices, and the people are familiar with the services that are provided there. The Chinese medicine clinics are not just about the outpatient consultation. It also covers the prescription of medication and so on. In the GOPCs, we don't have enough space, and that may not be a good idea to introduce this to the GOPC. So we are seeing how we can develop these 18 centers in a better way. Thank you.
Next, Mr. Ma Fengguo. Thank you. I'd like to follow on my own question. FHB H045. An extra $7 billion have been allocated to purchase anti-epidemic supplies and services. And the reply mentioned that 4.79 falls under head 140 for testing services and to prepare for reopening of the borders. Apart from the $4.7 billion, only $2.2 billion have been spent on anti-epidemic services and supply. As for the $4.2 billion, can you give us a breakdown on the expenditure items, or can you provide the details in writing? As for the renting of quarantine facilities, including quarantine centers and hotels, can you give us the respective expenses? Secretary, thank you very much. For the $4.7 billion spent on anti-epidemic supplies, if you wish to obtain a breakdown, we are happy to provide that after the meeting. For the use of hotels as community isolation facilities, the chief executive met with the hotel sector, asking them for support, and for that we are thankful for their support. Many hotels have been deployed as isolation facilities. Some Hong Kong residents are returning from other countries, so the demand for designated quarantine hotels have gone up. We now have more community isolation facilities with the help of the of the mainland authorities, and some of the current facilities could be converted into other uses. We are happy to provide a breakdown of the details. I'd like to know the utilization rates of these hotels or the occupancy rates. Hopefully the information can be offered. Secretary, we are happy to provide that information. Like I said, in our fight against the pandemic, our community isolation facilities include not only hotels. We have the Penny's Bay facility and at least six other community isolation facilities constructed with the help of the central authorities. So in terms of the use of hotels as isolation facilities, as the pandemic continues to ease, some of them have been converted into other purposes. We are happy to provide the information afterwards. Mr. Michael Tian. Thank you. I want to follow on reply number 045. $10.1 billion include the compulsory universal testing. Many experts said that when the daily caseload falls to double digits, compulsory testing can help us achieve zero cases and the borders could be reopened. The CE said we should wait for the right time, and she also talked about our capability. But before, she said that it wasn't realistic to implement universal testing in Hong Kong. So when the time is right, is Hong Kong actually capable of conducting universal testing? Did the government not believe that universal testing can achieve zero infections? As oral antivirals become more and more popular and the vaccination rates continue to go up, and with the construction of new makeshift hospitals, our anti-epidemic capabilities have been reinforced, and the social distancing measures will not need to be tightened again, unless we see more lethal viral strains. Do you agree with these views, Secretary? In terms of compulsory universal testing, earlier, the chief executive indicated that we are not giving up on compulsory universal testing. We have been preparing for the exercise, but timing is critical. So we adopt a science-based approach and would listen to the opinion of experts. In other words, you have the capability. We are preparing for the exercise. So we will continue to do our best. As for relaxation of social distancing measures, the pandemic has continued to stabilize despite a considerable number of cases. The government will continue to strike a balance between public health and the needs of the public. In the past 2 years or so, we have done a lot of work with different premises, and the public has been supportive. We have legislation in place to impose control on different premises, such as air ventilation in restaurants. We have reinforced control in these areas. If these measures are to be relaxed, it will be carried out in a gradual and phased manner. So do you agree with the experts that the extreme restrictions we saw in the past 3 months will be unlikely to happen again? That depends on the development of the pandemic or whether we see any new viral strains. Even with the Omicron strain, we will look at whether there are further outbreaks, and we will assess other indicators such as sewage. So it's too early to make a call right now. Mr. Duncan Chiu, Chairman, Secretary, good morning. I declare that I'm a member of the HA. I'd like to talk about 07227 and 044 about COVID. Many people have experienced a mental strain under COVID, and many have needs in terms of mental health. I wrote an article recently saying that there's an imbalance in Hong Kong on the provision of mental health services. We have adopted a community-based approach. It's time we maximize its effectiveness. And according to the reply, from April to December last year, more than 735,000 people sought help for mental health services, while our mental health centers received some 21 cases, up more than 900 compared with 2020 to 21. And the demand at other mental wellness NGOs also went up. At public hospitals, we had seven senior consultants, 11 consultants have left, and the attrition rate at Island West, etc., were especially high. And given the lack of manpower, community support is even more important. In your table, you said that there were new recruits, and in some districts, there is a net growth. But in some clusters, there is a negative growth. I'd like to know whether our community support measures are adequate and whether other plans are in place to help those with mental health needs, and support to their family members is equally important. As for the attrition of psychiatric doctors at DHA, I think training would take too long. So are you going to tackle the problem in other ways, such as PVP for the Shall We Talk campaign? It is a very important platform. You told us about the number of visits or hit rate. Can we collect more data points? Can we collect information on people who are seeking help and who they are? You asked three questions. For the community support program, we have an advisory committee on mental health. They offer regular services for youth and the elderly. Over the past 2 years or so, many people have been put under strain mentally. Mr. Chiu talked about the Shall We Talk campaign. You are right that the patients as well as their family members, including students and parents, all need help, and they are our service targets. As for psychiatric doctors, DHA can explain the wastage of psychiatric doctors and retention measures. Non-locally trained doctors would be an option for us as well. I defer to Dr. Koh. The secretary talked about retention of manpower, which is important. Over the past year, the HA has seen high wastage across different specialties, including psychiatric. Mr. Chiu talked about public-private partnership. This is something we are exploring. Of course, work has been challenging under COVID for our psychiatric services. They cover two main areas, one for more serious cases and the other, those who suffer depression, anxiety, etc. The latter is more common. Hopefully, we can do something to improve the situation through PVP. For patients with mental issues, long-term relationships must be established between patient and doctor. we have sought to develop telemedicine for psychiatric services. Very often, physical checks are not necessary. So these are examples of things we have done. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman Kwong, Chairman, for healthcare to be a success, prevention is important. 002, 030, and 035. 002 first. There are 9 PPP programs for surgery, treatment, and so on. And this will be extended to the diagnostic service. Now for these imaging and diagnostic needs, and over the past 3 years, we have seen 500,000 cases for the semi-urgent cases, and the waiting time is more like 3 years. Will the administration be extending the imaging radiography services to the private sector in order to shorten the waiting time? Because otherwise, cases would be pending for too long. Now, would this be extended to the Chinese medicine so that it would be better collaboration between the Chinese Western medicine? Also, the DHC, District Health Centers. I can see that the government is extending the DHCs. Other than the islands, the 8 DHCs have received the support of district councils, and they have already had the location. Will you give us the timetable for the completion on any ballpark figure? And how can you make sure that the programs will not be affected in their progress? Because this is important for us to have a good enough primary healthcare system. Secretary, thanks very much, Mr. Chow. The first question is about the public-private partnership or PPP. I could defer to the HA for more supplement. The FHB Secretary, we'll also face, but we can hear you. Please carry on. Am I coming through? Okay, thanks. We're in support of this 1 or 10 billion dollars have been set aside from the previous administration for this area of work, and Mr. Chow raised the other parts of the question. Later on, the hospital authority can address them. Chinese medicine, we've already started. We have the Chinese Medicine Development Fund. And we do have a program in the context of COVID. For the COVID-positive patients. And we commissioned the private Chinese medicine practitioners to help out, and also in the private sector. The third one is the primary healthcare system. Ms. Chow has a point that the DHCs are being built in different districts. We'd like to set up a network there. In this term of administration, we're going to have the blueprint for the primary health care. We're not just going to have the hardware. We do have the comprehensive plan to improve the primary health care system. In terms of the DHCs, 2 are up and running. As of now, the remaining 5 will be accommodated in leased places, so they can be rolled out, they can be put into service within this year. For the 11 DHC expresses, and they are on a transitional basis and of a smaller scale, they all of them have been opened. There are seven operators that are covering the DHC expresses in 11 districts. I'm grateful to the district council and the community people for their support. So we will be building these hardware on an ongoing basis. As to the location of the DHCs and the DHC expresses, we have identified the site for them. This is not just a program that will be launched individually. We do have a comprehensive plan and we do identify the land for them to be built. I don't think we have time for the HA, so will you please provide the reply in writing. Dr. Priscilla Leung, Chairman, FHB H042 and 043. We all understand that nobody wants COVID. Now we have a fatality rate of 8,000 people in the fifth wave. One of the reasons is there is a lack of contingency plan. We didn't build up our defense when the Omicron assaulted Hong Kong. We underestimated the impact. The fifth wave is approaching the end. We are worried about the resurgence if the schools are reopening and the students, some of them just have one shot and they are reopening the schools. Will the students be having sufficient immunity? The last thing we want to see is to have the sixth wave. For this, $7.5 billion for the HA to tackle the COVID, what sort of measures have been taken? Secretary, well, I take the first question first. I defer the second one to the HA. Now, Dr. Leung has always been very concerned about the situation regarding the reopening of schools. The CE has been discussing with the Education Bureau about this. The CHP will be monitoring the possible outbreak. Dr. Leung has got a point there. We do have plans in place to guard against any outbreak. So the daily RAT test is to enable us to get to grips with the numbers. When the number hits a certain level, that CHP will take precautionary measures. As to the vaccination, this is terribly important for young people. It's just as important for elderly people, but it is also important for the young people. So we have to step up our efforts to ramp up the vaccine coverage. Dr. Leung has a point. For the contingency plans, but to use your words, if there is any resurgence, and if the COVID situation were to reverse, we must have some contingency plan to curb the COVID. So in the scenario of the in-person classes being reopened, that we do have some contingency plan. Dr. Koh? Now with this extra funding, we are making preparation for the situation. Like we have to have the equipment, the medical supplies, the operation of the AWE, and all the support services for the hospitals. The most important thing is the procurement of medication. Over the past year or so, we have the new oral antiviral. We made every effort to procure the right amount so that we are fully prepared to guard against any possibility of a resurgence or the sixth wave. I hope that they will be more precise in formulating the contingency plan. We shouldn't really repeat what we experienced during the fifth wave. I think they have to be more specific. The secretary said that they've got the contingency plan, although she didn't tell us the specifics in the school context. I don't think we have time for Dr. Ko. Perhaps this can be done in writing. We have Mr. Liang Man Kwong, Mrs. Regina Ip, Mr. So Chong Wing, and Mr. Li Sai Wing. And I think we can bring in Mr. Dennis Lam, Dr. Dennis Lam, and Mr. Holden Chow as well. Perhaps they will take 3 minutes so that we can fit in as many members as possible. Mr. Liang Man Kwong, Chairman. 079 and 080 about dental service. The dental care program for the elderly homes, they have the outreach teams. There are many senior citizens who do not use the daycare center services, and they would go for the outpatient service, or sometimes they are using the healthcare voucher scheme, or they use the CCF services. Prevention is always better than cure. It would be too late for them to deal with the dental problems if the problems become acute. And that would also affect the health of the senior citizens. And I hope that the administration would do more in a way of prevention for the senior citizens in terms of dental care. The other question is the outpatient service for dental care. Because of COVID, the number of tickets distributed has been reduced by 25% and 50% respectively. And in terms of utilization rate, other than the remote areas, we are talking about 99% or 100%. Post-COVID, we would expect the government to resume the level of consultation, but will you be making up for the shortfall in the past? Many senior citizens, they may put up with the dental problems for 6 months or more. If you catch up with the shortfall, I'm sure that this is something that is well worth considering. Before I call upon Professor Chen, there are some problems with the screen. Perhaps we can sort out the technical problem before we continue. Let's wait a bit and let's hope that the FHB can sort out the screen. Let's take a break for 5 minutes and we may have to extend the meeting because with the last speaker will be Mr. Holden Chow.